following show is paid programming and does not necessarily express the views and opinions of Urban Broadcast Media and its subsidiaries.
Thank you for listening to UBM Praise.
Let's go. Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
Sir Walter Jones.
What's his name?
Sir Walter Jones.
What show is this?
Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
Sir Walter Jones.
Say it again.
Sir Walter Jones.
Who are you with?
Sir Walter Jones.
One more game.
Sir Walter Jones.
The Sir Walter Jones Show. Co-host Alvin Carter. We are a Christian talk show in where we tackle all the hot topics in a believer's walk.
Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
Sir Walter Jones.
What's his name?
Sir Walter Jones.
Who show is this?
Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
Sir Walter Jones.
Proverbs 18 and 10. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and is safe. Got a question about scriptures? Well, we got the answers. Just ask the elders. It's Theology Thursday, right here on the Sir Walter Jones Show.
Tell me, who can I run to?
Hello, everybody. So welcome to the Sir Walter Jones Show. I'm he. It is Thursday. Theology Thursday. We sit around a mic. Mic, that is, and talk to y'all about the Bible. The B-I-B-L-E, man. That's the book for me. We've been on this kick here, boy. Talking about the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost. And it has come to us in different forms. Water and oil. And a dove, and man, the Holy Spirit comes in a wind. It's a pneuma. We study pneumatology. And Elder Rodney Jones is a carpenter, so he drills with a pneumatic drill. Come on now, we can go there. The Holy Spirit has always been there from the inception, from the beginning. It didn't just pop up when he just fell on somebody in the Old Testament and then went away. Like rain do. He was there when God said, let us. And then there was. Okay. Yes, I'm coughing. I do that every day from 4 to 6. I get the tack around 4 to 6 o'clock. Facebook Live, you guys will be chiming in soon. Facebook, the wall, you guys will be chiming in a minute as well. We're talking about the Holy Ghost. This is our last series of session of the 6-part series. I don't know how many parts we've done so far. This might be part 4. The Holy Ghost in the Old Testament. Did Holy Ghost change on us in the New Testament? Although it seems to some of you like he acted different in the Old Testament. He'd fall on somebody and overcome somebody, and then boom, he gone. It seems like there was a hint because one man says, don't take your spirit away from me.
Yes, sir.
As if he was here temporarily, and then he can leave. All right?
Or he lost it.
There you go.
Mm-hmm.
So L. Jones is going to help us break this out of the box here. Sharina Robinson said, looking forward to hearing this one from Pastor, you're her pastor, by the way.
Oh, right. Where's my tie?
You know what I'm saying? Where your tie? T-I-D-E.
Yeah, my tie.
Because y'all seen this shirt collar lately?
Yeah. I'll take all temperature cheer.
Oh, Abronia Scott says, that was just a prelude as to what to expect. What was to come as prophesied through Joel.
Oh, so is that the song, What's to Come is better than
what's something. Been. Yeah.
Okay.
Phyllis Williams been with me all day. Phyllis, you my heart. Give him a glass of ice water to sip. This helps me. All right. Well, no, I got tea right here, my dear. Tea. All right, L. Jones.
Yes, sir, doctor.
We need to recap.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, we need to recap this thing like this tea is overflowing here.
Yes, let it overflow.
Let it overflow. Man, I got to find that song. Let it overflow.
Overflow.
So many overflow songs out there.
Oh, yes.
So help us out, Doc Jones, Sugar. How do we recap this? We've been talking about the workings of the Holy Spirit.
Yes, we've been talking about the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost. we covered a whole lot of grounds, but you know how it is. Sometimes when you cover a lot of grounds, people forget the beginning.
They do.
So sometimes you have to go back and just give some tidbits, some here's and some nouns and whatever. We were talking about how that the Holy Ghost is also called Holy Ghost or Holy Spirit. We always go back to John where Jesus talks about that he's the Spirit of truth. He will lead and guide you into all truth. He is a teacher. He's a speaker. We also talked about how that he is a witness. And not only is he a witness, but he witnesses Christ in you. And then when you're speaking to others, he witnesses to you about Christ. And then he causes you to be a witness to others about Christ.
Okay.
And then we also talked about how that he did not just come on the scene in the New Testament, but like the song says, he was there,
he was there all the time.
Yes. We talked about that. He gives gifts. He gives spiritual gifts. And today we would like to talk about, you ever had a pastor who, you know, he's gifted to pastor, right?
Yes.
But for some reason, he's not prospering as a pastor.
Mm-hmm.
It may be that he may be missing a mark.
Okay.
Take it now. Yes, he is called to be a pastor. Uh-huh. He's gifted to be a pastor, but he may be pastoring the wrong church.
Oh.
So maybe we'll find out. Maybe he is pastoring the wrong church. You may have get the gift, but maybe you're at the wrong location. So possibly we'll deal with those things as well.
Well, L. Jones, could it possibly be that, and this is my firm belief, that just because he's the pastor doesn't mean he has to pastor a building, a traditional pastor sitting in a pulpit?
Yeah, it could be.
Okay,
yes.
Because I think a lot of my Caucasian friends got it right.
Mm-hmm.
In their churches, when they would hire me to be part of the music department, they would call me Pastor Jones.
Yes, sir.
I didn't have no license then.
Mm.
No, I wasn't ordained or anything like that.
Oh,
They called me Pastor Jones because I was pastor over music.
Okay.
You see what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
So you see what my question is?
Yes, sir.
I think there's some people out there on the street who are, for instance, Sharina called you her pastor.
Yes, and I can understand that.
She don't belong to your church.
She sure doesn't.
You see what I'm saying?
I don't know her from Adam's cat.
No, Adam's cat, okay? Right. Right, okay? But I have hundreds of people on Facebook say that I'm their pastor.
Yes.
I've been their pastor for the past about 3 years now.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Because for a couple of reasons. Number one, several of them don't really attend church on a regular basis.
Yeah.
So the only gospel that they're really getting is from the Sir Walter Jones Show.
And I can understand that too.
All right. Number two, some of them do attend church, but they're not being fed.
They're not being fed. And I can understand that as well.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And it's not a sin for them to get their information from the Sir Walter Jones. See, the thing about the Holy Ghost, he's the teacher.
Yeah, he is.
And wherever you're taught, if you're understanding it, that's the work of the Holy Ghost.
Mm.
It's to bring understanding. And God uses many locations for you to learn, because you know how it is. If your pastor taught you everything, what happens? We tend to worship the pastor.
Mm.
Right? You remember that brazen serpent?
Yes, sir.
The song we call Look and Live? Well, when God sent the serpents to kill the people, he instructed Moses to erect a brazen serpent,
right,
and tell them to look and live. Later, Israel started worshiping the serpent, golden serpent, the brazen serpent.
Yeah.
So anything we get blessed from, what happens is we tend to worship that.
Whew.
So God has to separate it and calls us not only to learn from others, but others learn from us as well.
Oh my.
Cause us to depend on one another.
Jones.
Yes, sir.
Boy, you something else.
Mm.
I was watching the Dr. Oz show today.
Yes.
They were talking about parasites.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I got a great message from that.
Mm-hmm.
Here's something that y'all didn't know. Now, check this out, Joe.
Checking.
There is a parasite that attaches on to a rat.
Mm.
All right?
Mm-hmm.
The nature of a rat is to be afraid of a cat.
Right.
The nature of the cat is to chase the rat.
Mm-hmm.
But there was a parasite that links on to the brain cell of a rat.
Mm.
And what it does is it tricks the brain so that what the rat does is looks at the cat as not something to fear, but is attracted to the cat now.
Oh, okay.
Almost sexually.
Oh, wow.
Yes. So it gets turned on by a cat, and then instead of it running from the cat, it runs to the cat, and the cat and eats it.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
I just saw that today.
Really?
Isn't that something?
That's a pair of who?
It's a parasite.
Parasite. Mm-hmm. Wow.
Mm-hmm.
So can that be equivalent to people being attracted to the devil?
See, I knew he was going. I see.
Yeah,
that's he come up under the Joneses. Them some mighty men of God.
Mighty had big heads, but mighty.
yeah.
So there are some people who are attracted to the devil.
There are some people who are attracted to the devil. Yes.
Yes.
The devil has planted some parasites.
Parasites. And so they can't really see that they are really worshiping him.
Yep.
There are satanic Bibles. There are satanic churches. There are satanic worshipers. And when they should be, I want for the lack of a better word, afraid of the devil, they worship him.
Yeah.
Even though he's subject to eat them, but yet they still worship him. So they have a parasite.
Man, where's my pen?
Wow.
Ain't that something?
Yes, sir.
You can find so many messages from just looking at the animal kingdom.
Oh, man, yes.
Just a great, I mean, I think one of the biggest messages that came out of me came out of the animal kingdom story is where who was it? What's that animal? It's one of the cat families. I think it's a leopard. The leopard sees a dead carcass, and he goes and smells it. But even though it's hungry, it won't eat the dead carcass. Because it's dead and he didn't kill it.
Gotcha.
And because there's some nature in it that says it possibly is diseased. So I'm not going to mess with it.
Right.
But when it finds something that's walking around,
He
kills it. And then what he does is he or she takes it up a tree and devours it up in the tree.
Wow.
He won't eat it on the ground. He eats it up in the tree. Okay. So, man, Doc, I know you want to go there.
But what about the eagle? Doesn't the eagle come down on the ground, grabs its prey, and take them up in the air?
Yes, sir.
Oh, yes, sir.
Sure do.
Yes, sir.
Sure
now, I believe a lot of that God gets glory in that God shows a portion of him in the animal kingdom.
He does.
You know?
Yes.
Wow. I mean, but look at the thing that, what those birds, that they only want dead things?
Vultures.
Vultures, yeah. And when you see them, you know that's, and I believe that they are wise. They know when death is about to appear.
They do.
They got a sense that.
They hang around.
But it's like, and I believe that there are some people who hang around dead churches.
Yes, sir.
All they are vultures. Mm-hmm. And they don't like nothing live. They only go around dead stuff. Them the people who only watches what comes on Wednesdays or Thursdays. It's about an adulterous relationship with a president.
Scandal.
I mean, them the people.
They love it.
They love it. They and you are what you eat.
Yes, you are.
So you are what you watch.
Yes.
Facebook, you are.
What you watch. Yes, sir.
Because you eat what you watch. You take it in your eye gate, your ear gate, you receive it through your mouth gate, and then it becomes a part of you. Yes. You can't even go to church good enough because you got your mind on what's going on Empire and what's going on with Scandal.
Yeah.
Oh,
that's so true. I know it's addictive though.
Yes, it is.
That's really what it is.
It starts innocent.
It does start innocent.
And then the full blown thing comes out.
Absolutely. Go back to the eagle. I think there's one of the great analogies that I have discovered is that the eagle, he feels more comfortable in the air.
Yes, he does.
Okay. Now his food is on the ground.
Yes.
All right. But what he does is he'll go to the ground to catch the food, but he won't eat the food on the ground.
Exactly.
He eats the food where he lives.
That's it.
In the air. That's up it. In the nest, nesting area. Mm-hmm. Okay. The snake, his domain is on the ground.
Yes.
Okay. And I've seen this on the Animal Kingdom. I said, oh my God, that's a message. What the bird does is he goes down there and he grabs the snake.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, as long as the bird is trying to tassel with the snake on the ground, he's in danger.
Yes.
Because the snake knows the ground quite
well.
Yes,
it does. Yes, it does.
That's how he got Eve.
Okay. That's right.
They were rolling on the ground. All right. Okay. He knows the ground quite well. So that bird took the, I saw it. He took the, picked the thing up
and took it
in
the air.
And as I began to hear, you know what the announcer said?
What's that?
As far as the bird took that snake, the snake couldn't breathe.
Exactly.
Because the atmosphere changed for
the him. Atmosphere changes. That's what the pilot did when he heard the noise in the back of the plane.
Yes.
And he asked the co-pilot, what's that noise? And he said, there's a rat back there.
Yeah.
So what are we going to do? So the pilot, they said, took the plane up a few notches. He said, what's going on now? He said, his eyes are starting to bulge. All right, took it up a little bit more. Said, what's going on? He says his head is shaking and his tail is wagging. He said, all right, I'm going to take him up another notch. So he took the plane all the way up. He said, what's going on now? He said, he's flat out dead.
He changed the atmosphere.
He changed the atmosphere. And that's what we got to do in worship. All we got to do is change the atmosphere. And anything that's not conducive for God will die because we begin to be too high for a snake to survive.
No, my Lord, have mercy. Too high, too
high.
That's
when people get all fidgety and got to leave.
Yep, yep. They're sitting there in your church and they're like, what is this? What is this?
I did that at our church one time years ago. We had one in the back of the church, all prancing, whole night. Yeah, I told the saints, don't worry, let's go high enough. When we get high enough, he won't survive.
Hey, Chris just said something very interesting. Thank you, Chris Patterson. Great analogy. He said, taking animals out of their natural habitat will unsettle them. Okay, now watch what he says next. He says, and then some adapt.
Yes.
So there's some animals.
Yeah, they can adapt.
There is,
but not that swift.
Yeah, not that swift. Take some time to adapt. Now you keep a. Oh, that's why the Holy Spirit, as we're talking about, have to work in us strong.
Yes.
So some of we get saved and then we have the Holy Ghost.
And fast.
Okay, because then when we get the Holy Ghost, we think that we could change the world once we get saved.
Right.
But no, because there is this feeling, this thing that the Holy Spirit have to work in us even stronger. So that goes by fasting, by praying, by reading your word, going before the Lord and all these things. And so he's saying here, another great analogy is the adaptation of the enemy.
Yes, sir.
Okay, because you say, okay, remember the roaches that we grew up with?
Yeah, the one you grew up with.
That you grew up with?
Yeah, the one, because the one I grew up with, they flew.
They did fly, didn't they?
Yes, sir.
Our roaches started, we would buy Raid, and we would spray the Raid.
We had to spray it in the air.
Uh-huh.
Because they would.
Yeah, we had to spray it in the air.
Because they would fly.
But watch this, L. Jones.
Mm-hmm.
The Raid, they've started drinking it like water.
Yes, sir. They become immune to it.
They became immune and adapted to that Raid, so you had to buy our stronger stuff.
Well, you know, the Bible says when an unclean spirit, he leaves this body, right?
Yes, sir.
And he leaves, but he comes back and he finds it clean.
Yes, sir.
But and garnished and swept, right?
Yeah.
I mean, you can tell that Calgon and Ajax was here. You could tell Ajax was here, right? But the Bible says one problem is empty.
Yeah, he didn't need
to. So what he does is he goes and gets seven other ones and come back. So in other words, what the Holy Ghost does is when he comes in to clean us, sanctify us, purify us, he has to immediately fill us. Because if he does not immediately fill us, then whatever we're in, whatever state we're in, we'll become immune sometimes to the Holy Ghost.
Right.
And then we'll adapt with the Holy Ghost being within us, but we'll adapt to him being just resident in us. And so many people live for 20 and 30 years not baptized or not fully engulfed with the Holy Ghost because they become accustomed, they become used to, they adapt to the presence of the Holy Ghost, but then they still allow their flesh to rule at times. Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Yep, I do.
So there's another thing. It's called adaptation. An adaptation is not good.
Right.
So, there's another thing also. If when a person gets saved, if they don't completely give their life over to the Lord 100%, then there'll be years before they receive the fullness of the Holy Ghost.
Yes, I agree with that.
Because they did not give him their complete heart at the point of receiving him.
At the point of receiving him.
Yes, and that's just like that animal who will adapt in the air.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You see what you kicked off Chris Patterson? I don't know what the problem is, but you got the brother stirred up over there. Preacher to his church says the balance is key. We can eat ice cream sometimes in moderation. Read your Bible daily and enjoy a worldly TV show. Keep it in perspective. What are you saying there?
I guess he's saying you can watch some stuff, so worldly TV or whatever, but you have to be moderate about it.
I see what you're saying.
Yeah.
Okay. Natalie said that's them Texas roaches. I think they call them German cockroaches. That's
yeah. Well, I heard that the ones in Florida, they so humongous, you look like a grown man or a midget walking up towards you.
Yeah, man. But, and that's true. Moderation is important. A matter of fact, the scripture says, I think Proverbs says, many people never read this before, but it talked about removing somebody out of your house.
Mm-hmm.
A person comes to your house, and I love how the analogy is that you have to eventually remove them, because it says too much honey will make a man vomit.
Yes.
So then it says, so remove a person from your house. Person keeps showing up at your house, just unannounced, just hanging around there. Mm-hmm. You invited them in, and you enjoy their company, and after a while,
it's time to them leave, but they don't. They don't. Yeah. Yeah,
that's in Proverbs. Much. Yeah, somebody got to find that, okay? Proverbs, it says something about too much honey makes a man vomit. You just go there. let's see. Those roaches migrated from Mississippi with the people.
them Mississippi roaches was lazy.
Well, L. Jones, Johnetta Reed is on here.
Who that?
Johnetta.
Oh, yeah, my sister. Is it a Robinson or something
Well,
like that?
Well, it's Missionary Richardson.
That's so, my girl.
We can't change the world until we allow the Holy Spirit to change us from the inside out. He has to put us in the heavenly fire to burn off those things that is not of God. Let's see. It says see more. So then he will fill us. We must be willing to submit and receive. Mm-hmm. Now, that's good because do the Holy Spirit force himself on us?
No, he's a gentleman.
Okay.
Yeah, God is a gentleman too. He still open doors.
Yes, sir. That's a good one right there.
He's a gentleman. He's still open doors.
That's a good one.
I have set before thee an open door.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Jonathan Williams says, in order for you to be able to define your destiny in God, you must be willing to allow God's direction to be your total focus.
Yes.
And rest on the fact that he knows the plan for your life.
Yes, he does.
I think he's tag teaming Richardson.
Okay.
I'm not saying that he read what she said, but they're right in sync with each other.
Yes, that's how the Holy Ghost
focus
does it.
That
total focus.
Capitalized and rest on the fact that total he focus. Knows the plan for your life.
Yes. And he sets that plan out.
Mm-hmm.
Matter of fact, he not only knows the plan. I heard a song, can't remember. You got to be careful on all of these songs. Some of these songs are just not hitting it.
No, no.
It sounds good, but it's just not true.
Right.
The song says everything the devil told me was a lie, was a lie, was a lie. No, he told you some truth.
He did.
He told Eve some truth.
He sure did tell her truth.
He ain't that stupid. That's why he's the wisest. He's wise. He's subtle. So he knows how to mix truth with lie. So everything he told you wasn't the truth. What wasn't a lie?
That's a good thing. And I'm saying something controversial. He tells you more truth than you lie.
Yes.
Yeah,
of course.
Yeah. I made this analogy many times on the show about that Decon rat poison.
Yes.
That when I turned it around, it said it had 95% good food in it, 5% poison.
Mm-hmm.
So the rat is not attracted to the poison.
No.
It's attracted to, so they had to pump all this good food in for the rat to be attracted
to
it.
Exactly.
But it's only 5% that kills it.
Right. And then there's another sense because the rat too stupid to read.
The rat is too stupid to read.
Yeah.
Must be a Chicago rat.
Well, you know what? And he ain't the only one too stupid to read.
Oh, I'm not going to go there. But you're right. And I think Facebook know who you're talking about. Them people.
Some are just too lazy to read.
Some are just too lazy.
Yes.
They're giving me this. Thank you. Who gave it to me first? Angela Garrett. Well, I think Angela Garrett and Preacher just gave me the scripture, Proverbs 25.
Yes, sir.
and 16.
Yes, sir. Hast thou found honey?
Yes.
That's the one you're talking about?
Yes, sir.
Eat so much as is sufficient for thee,
mm-hmm.
lest thou be filled therewith and vomit
mm-hmm.
it.
And what did it say after that?
I don't know. I just, it's on my reference.
Oh, got you. But then 17, you know what it say?
What it say?
Withdraw thy foot from thy neighbor's house, lest he be weary of thee and so hate you.
Yeah. Yes.
Y'all showing about these folks' houses, man. They're like, okay, all right, I get it. You're a great neighbor and what have you. Come over here, borrow some sugar. But man, please, you're making me vomit. I'm tired of seeing you.
Yeah. I like verse 19, though.
What did it say?
Confidence in an unfaithful man in time of trouble is like a broken tooth and a foot out of joint.
Oh, my God. L. Jones, what can you do with a broken tooth?
Nothing but cry.
What about a broken, what's that, a broken what? Ankle?
A foot out of joint.
A foot out of joint.
You can't do nothing.
Can
your foot out,
rest you rest on it?
You can't rest on it. You can't walk. You can't do nothing but cry. And it's usually hurting. And your tooth is usually hurting at midnight when everything is closed.
Oh, my God, yes. And the worst pain in the body is a bad tooth.
It's a bad tooth. Yet, you're going to confide in an unfaithful man.
An unfaithful man.
And in the time of trouble,
yeah.
he's going to show you his unfaithfulness.
Yes, he will.
He's going to tell the whole world.
He's going to show the whole world.
He's going to show the whole world your confidence that you can and you confided in him.
Patriotist, no break, no. Patriotist says, I never eat more honey than you need. Too much may make you vomit. Don't visit your neighbors too often.
Mm-hmm.
They may get tired of you and come hate you. She must be reading, probably giving us a different translation.
Yes.
But this is pretty much what it's saying. Phyllis Williams says, the problem is people want to pick and choose. The Holy Spirit is not Burger King.
No, he's not. He's not have it your way.
Mm-mm. Hold the pickles, hold the lettuce.
Special orders, don't upset us. All we ask is that you let us.
Serve it your way. And you Randy Allen Rippey.
You know I am. Where's the beef?
Mm-hmm. Wrong burger.
Oh, I know.
Yeah.
So all beef patty, special sauce, lettuce, cheese, pickles, onions. Oh, I mean, I know the commercials.
Yeah, boy.
But you know what? We can get too much of church.
Yes, sir. Help us out with that.
I know a sister that they have 3 services a day in the church, and she's single. And she goes to all 3 services, and guess what? She will always be single
for the rest of my life.
Yeah, it's fine to have 3 services, but everything is about balance. You can have too much church.
You sure can.
Because there are people who are just churched out, but they're no earthly good. They're no good. They're always strung out on the job. They don't get no rest. The focus is now on pastor.
Yes.
And not the gospel. You know, it's all on the prophetic word,
yes.
but not the gospel message itself.
That's so true.
And so you can get too much of that honey and all you good as far as vomit.
Oh, my God. That's the purpose of the whole song. Take me to the king.
Take me to the king.
She said, I'm all churched
out. I'm all church. Truth is, she says.
Truth is.
I'm all churched out.
I'm tired.
Yeah. Take me to the king.
Ooh-wee.
And that's a beautiful, and that's what we ought to do. So if. Let's get on something about this pastoring thing.
Okay.
About why is it could be that some of the pastors just may not be hitting it. You know, we're in this day and time where we feel that everything has to have a conference, counseling, sessions. And all of that, in other words, if a young man says, the Lord called me to preach, now we deem that he has to go to college, he's got to go to Bible school, he's got to go through a whole lot, he's got to be ordained, he's got to wait 4 years before he get his minister's license, he's got to prove himself, he got to go through a series of tests and all of that,
yes.
right?
Yes.
But Paul didn't go through none of that.
No, he didn't.
You know what I'm saying?
That's so true.
Matter of fact, it was 14 years later before Paul received the right hand of fellowship. And Paul said in the book of Galatians, he didn't even confer with man. Why is it that we deem it necessary Ooh. And important for a man to be trained on how to prophesy, trained on his spiritual gift? Why does he have to be trained by you? Who is it that said that you're the one who helped to teach and train him? The school of prophecies, the school of prophet, the school of ministry. You see all these schools being open?
Oh, boy.
So yet, it's not effective because the wrong person is doing the training.
Oh, my goodness, man.
So I got to see your credentials before I let you in my pulpit.
That's so true. Got to see your credentials. And that this is a man-made religion, isn't it?
Yes, it is. And he runs it.
He does run it. And your pastor tells you, you can't preach over there. I know a church right now who the pastor, they've got elders and ministers there, but they're not allowed to preach nowhere else.
Yes.
They keep them at home.
Isn't that something?
They can't do it.
And Jesus said, go out to the world.
Yeah.
He told the pastor to stay, but he told everybody else to go out and make disciples, right?
That's a good point right there.
Yeah, that's what I told my pastor. The Bible told you to stay.
Yeah, you stay.
Because you're a pastor. Uh-huh. But yet, Monday through Saturday, you're still an elder.
Ooh.
So you got to go.
Yes, sir. Boy, you know I'm going to hit you. I'm going to hit you right
here. See, every pastor has a tool. Every pastor is still a preacher.
It sure is.
And every preacher has to go out to proclaim the gospel.
I'm gonna hit you, man.
Only the pastors what stays because pastors are local position.
And the shepherd.
He's a shepherd.
Takes care of the sheep.
He takes care of the sheep. Mm-hmm. But he is a shepherd and a fisherman.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
See, because a fisherman fishes for sheep. Mm-hmm. But by the time he gets metamorphosis, he goes from fish to sheep. Because a pastor does not pastor fish.
That's true.
He pastors sheep.
He eat fish.
He eat fish and he scales the sheep.
Yeah, he does.
That's how he stay warm from the wool.
Man.
It's time me to shear you.
Yeah. We're not talking about you, Drew Sheard.
No, not this time.
Hey, Brittany, H. Lord, I need you. Lord, I need you. H. Okay, that's at 5 o'clock. Jonathan Williams says, I believe it is because people are running towards the office of pastor but are not called to it.
Okay,
They run to it. There's a desired office that many of us covet.
Yeah, and it's fine.
Yeah.
The Bible says that he that desires the office of a bishop desires a good work. Now, the problem is we think the word bishop means jurisdictional bishop. There were no jurisdictional bishops. The things that the bishops or jurisdictional bishops are doing today is the same work of the apostles.
Yes, sir.
The apostles had that authority. And now we're creating more words. Now we don't just have bishops, but now we got archbishops. I mean, come on.
I can't do this.
You know, and I'm not speaking against no one in particular.
I am.
But there's some stuff that we have really made that's non-biblical. A pastor and a bishop technically is the same office.
Man.
They both are overseers. Now, let's go. You want to go to some scripture? Go ahead.
Right. Because I want to stay on this bishop thing right here.
Yeah.
Was that where you were going to go?
Well, somewhat. Go where you want
to
go.
Well, 1 Timothy 3, I want to explain what a bishop is.
And yes, sir.
This is a true saying.
I know it's a true story.
If a man desires the office of a bishop, he desires a good work.
Mm.
Then it talks about that he must be blameless and vigilant and what have
1 Timothy what?
1 Timothy chapter 3.
Uh-huh.
But watch what my footnotes say.
Yes, sir.
Because sometimes footnotes be on point. Sometimes they don't.
Sometimes they don't.
Sometimes you feel like a nut.
And sometimes you don't.
Right here it says, the office of a bishop is not the monarchical episcopate. You're talking about a monarch.
Uh-huh.
Because that's what y'all have turned these churches into.
Yes, sir.
He said, it's not a monarchical episcopate, which developed later.
Right.
The Greek word episcopos designates a local pastoral oversight.
Yes, sir.
Hence.
And not a parasite.
Right. Hence, a better word than bishop to express his meaning may be supervisor. Or overseer.
Overseer.
Paul elsewhere uses the words presbyter.
Presbyterian.
Or elder.
Uh-huh.
To refer to the same office.
Same office.
Out of Titus chapter 1, verse 5.
Mm-hmm.
Before the bishop takes the oversight of the flock. Okay, then he goes on to the...
Yeah, because in Titus or Philippians, he said unto the bishops and the deacons.
He sure did.
Now, there's a misnomer in 1 Timothy 3 because we say that the bishop and the deacon share the same qualifications. Slightly they do. But the problem is we say that the deacon is apt to teach. No, the deacon is not apt to teach.
That's right, sir.
He's not apt to teach if we read... Certain words lets us know. But now, Here's another problem.
I'm about to go there.
Yeah, here's another problem. It says, this is a true saying. If a man, now, is it, can you say if a person desires the office of a bishop?
Oh.
Or is it specifically male gender?
Uh-oh.
Now, if it is not, if it's either or, what do you do with it when it says he must be blameless, the husband of one wife?
Right. You have to, I can't do that with you.
I mean, sometimes you can change some stuff, but sometimes you can't.
Sometimes you can't.
Here he said the husband
right.
of one wife.
That's so true.
Now, I don't want to mess with that. I'm just going to leave that right
with
there.
It. Nope. Nah. I'm already in trouble with
it. Yeah,
with
I'll let Timothy mess with
I
that.
I did a midday manner today. I talked about women putting up these negative portrayals of men on Facebook. They all these negative posts on Facebook about men.
Yeah.
Every time I turn around, I talk for about an hour, and I, you know, trust me, the women were throwing rocks at me. So I'm not confused with you today.
That what happened to your eye?
That, yeah, I got rock eye. Okay, but likewise, must the deacons be grave?
Yes.
No, not double tongued.
Not double tongued.
Not given too much wine.
Yeah. Now notice one verse 3 says not given to wine.
Yep.
For the bishop.
Mm-hmm.
So one can't drink as much as the other, anyhow.
One can't drink, the other one can.
Can, for some sake. No.
He just can't be drunk.
Right. But look at the word given to. It's the key word.
Yeah.
Now, and I'm not promoting drinking.
Right.
Okay. But look at the word. The key thing is we've got to look at the Bible in its original context and keep it in the context of the scripture that it's in. And then the only way for us to determine what it means today is we've got to rightly divide the word of truth.
Yes.
Correct?
Yes.
Now, the word given to simply means to be in the custody of.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, you got no business allowing the wine to dictate to you what you're supposed to do.
Right.
So if you have a father and a mother in a custody battle and you say that the child is given to the mother. That's the same thing he's saying about wine, not given to wine.
That's a good analogy.
Are you seeing what I'm saying?
Great explanation.
In other words, you're not going to be standing around the wine barrel all day and all night, and it's telling you what to do.
Mm-hmm.
So not given to. It's you're not controlled by it, is what he's saying.
That's good stuff. Great stuff.
Because they drank wine in the Bible.
Well, they had to.
Because the water was no good.
The water was horrible.
Exactly.
The preacher just says a wife of one husband at a time.
At a time. That's right. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Seven wives, one for each day. I mean, that's what it appears to be.
Yes, sir.
I'm just saying. I'm just saying.
We polygamous today, boy.
I'm
going on to my seven wives.
It's I don't know, Doc. I'm just, the devil is really slick.
Yeah, he is slick.
And we have
the Jerry Curl.
We have just completely stopped reading the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
Read the Word of God. Allow the Holy Spirit to dictate to you what he means in scripture and fulfill his will. Forget what everybody else is doing.
Yeah.
Because you'll find out that a lot of people we're following is not doing what God says.
Mm.
Man takes words and he colloquializes the Bible now.
He do.
You know, it's a colloquial term. That's how we preach now, by colloquial phrases. No, preach the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Now, let's go.
Because I decree and declare that's where he going. Did I say that? Yeah.
Now let's deal with Pastor. What is that? Ephesians 4, right? Ephesians 4 and 11, right? Let's go there right quick. Ephesians 4.
Read, baby. Let's see.
Yes.
Ephesians 4 and 7, right?
Yes, sir.
You want me to read it? You go.
Yes, sir. You read it.
Ephesians 4 and 7 says, but unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ.
Where are you reading it?
You said Ephesians chapter 4?
4, uh-huh.
And verse 7.
Okay.
Because he's going into the fivefold ministry, right?
Five of them. Mm-hmm.
Wherefore, he says, when when he has ascended up on high, he led captivity captive.
Yes, he did.
And gave gifts unto men.
Gave gifts unto men.
Now that he ascended, what is it? But that he also descended
first
into the lower parts of the earth.
Mm-hmm.
He that descended is the same also.
Same one.
That ascended.
Mm-hmm.
Up from above all heavens, that he might feel all things.
Feel all things. He had to go up that he can feel all things.
Yes, he did. Mm-hmm. And then he gave some.
He gave some what?
Apostles.
Apostles.
And then some.
Some.
Prophets.
Prophets.
And then some.
Some.
Evangelists.
Not all, but some. Evangelists. Now, there is two evangelists.
Okay.
Right? There's an evangelist according to Ephesians 4.
Mm-hmm.
Then there's an evangelist that everybody pastor makes them.
True.
And there's a difference in the two.
Yes.
Because there are pastors, and I'm not speaking against pastors and making whatever, but sometimes we make individual whatever based on what we see and not based on the leading of the Holy Ghost.
That's so true.
So just because a person is always helpful to you,
mm-hmm.
they may have the gift of helps.
That's true.
Why do you make them a leader?
Lord have mercy.
The minute you make them a leader, you pull them out of their category.
You do.
And you've messed up. You've went above the Holy Ghost.
You sent them.
You sent them.
Yes, the Holy Ghost didn't.
He didn't send them. And they will never be...
They will keep failing.
They will keep failing because mm-hmm. they're in the wrong place.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And you have become the sender.
Yes.
And rather than the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
So an individual who's constantly boosting, he's a second man.
Yes.
He's man number two. That's his gift.
That's his gift.
You can't make him number one.
Right.
So even though the pastor dies, just because he was the best help that the pastor made or had, does not mean he qualifies to be the pastor.
Mm-mm-mm.
It means he still needs to stand in that position.
Yes, sir.
And remain as that assistant or whatever he is. Now, watch this. Now, you did say pastors, right?
I did say pastors. No, mm-hmm. I said evangelists.
Evangelists.
Then, uh-huh. And some pastors.
Some pastors.
And teachers.
And teachers. Now, you notice the two categories. We talked about that before.
Mm-hmm.
The first category is a worldwide. It's a global category. That's when you have the evangelists, the apostles.
Evangelists.
And
prophets.
The prophets. Those are not local positions.
No, they're not.
And I know sometimes we want to have a fivefold ministries all at the same church.
Right.
But that's not designed.
Right.
For your local church to have the fivefold ministry.
I agree now.
Twofold is local. The sure pastor is a shepherd. He's mm-hmm. an overseer of the local assembly. The teacher is the one that teaches them how to remain saved and everything else. But the apostle, the prophet, and the evangelist are global works, global ministries. And it gives us these in the two categories that it gives us in.
Sure does.
Now, let's deal with the pastor. So your pastor has the gift of pastoring.
Right.
Right. So he goes and the other pastor dies. Right.
Right.
So he goes from being the assistant pastor to the pastor, but then the church defrocks.
Right.
Yet he's still the pastor
yeah.
because pastoring is a gift.
Mm-hmm.
And what we fail to realize is there's fivefold.
Right.
All five of them. Has to be gifted by Jesus Christ.
Yes, sir.
It was him that gave the gifts, right?
Right.
Now, let's look at Acts 20 and 28. We're dealing with the pastor or the bishop or the overseer. Acts 20 and 28. This is proof right here that just because he's pastoring does not mean he's supposed to pastor at that particular location. You can be good. You can be a skillful musician, but you may not be comfortable where you are.
Man.
You can preach a sermon at Bishop Moody's church and be comfortable and flow in the spirit and then go right down the street and get lockjaw.
Sure can. That's so true.
Because sometimes it's not the will of the Holy Ghost that you are there.
Yes.
So look at what Acts 20 and 28 says.
Well, it says, take heed therefore unto yourselves
mm-hmm.
and to all of the flock.
Until all of the flock.
Over the which the Holy Ghost has mm-hmm. made you overseers.
To do what?
To feed the church of God.
Uh-huh. Which
he hath purchased with his own blood.
Now, whose church is it?
The church of God.
It's God's church, and he purchased it with his own blood, right?
Sure did.
Now, he called you an overseer, right?
He did.
But who made you the overseer?
Bishop Tutu?
Yeah, Smith.
Bishop Tutu from Africa.
So Acts 20 and 28 says that, first of all, he says, take heed therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock, over the which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers.
Sure did.
So Jesus gave you the gift to be a pastor, right?
He did.
Yet it was the Holy Ghost who placed you to be overseer over a particular flock.
Sure was.
And then he says for you to take the oversight thereof.
Mm.
The oversight.
Yeah.
So that's why I believe that a lot of times, yes, you've been gifted to be a pastor, but just because the other pastor died. And you know that's how we do it. Just in because
succession,
in succession, because your father or your grandfather, or this is your great grandfather's church, or because you're the first presiding, or because so you feel like you fall in order as next. That only happened in the kings.
Right.
You had to be bloodline to be a king, but not with the spirit and the power of God.
You know what it's called?
What's that?
Dynasty.
Yes, it is.
It's a dynasty.
That was a good series.
It sure was. Pretty much. That's what it's called. Our church is
shot J.R.? But go ahead.
Some girl. Our churches are set up in two types of systems.
Yes.
We talked about this in one of our shows.
Mm-hmm.
A monarchy and a dynasty.
Yes, sir.
Okay. And both of which God didn't say. Because man have placed these people in the office, and then man places people in those successions. That's why when your pastor die, mm-hmm. the bishop comes in.
Yes, sir.
All right. There's one or two things he's going to do.
Mm-hmm.
He's going to appoint.
Point or okay. accept.
Man.
Yes, sir.
I'm trying to tell y'all this boy.
And if
here.
He don't like your appointment.
Yeah, he's going to override it.
He's going to override it, and he's going to appoint who he wants.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Regardless, forget the fact that the Holy Ghost operates and runs this church. Forget that.
Forget it.
Man have said, this is my church, and I do what I want to do.
Ooh-wee.
That's why the church is failing.
The church is failing. We set our churches up. I did a show called Jesus, Democrat, Moderate, or Republican. Okay? Y'all go to that show. All right? It was sometime last year.
Mm-hmm.
Go to Spriggan. All right? We talked about communism, socialism, Nazism, fascism,
mm-hmm.
princes, potentates. Okay.
The Bible said that he is the only potentate.
Come on, man.
Mm-hmm.
Dictators, kings, and totalitarians.
Wow.
Which is North Korea, is a totalitarian. Our
yeah.
churches are set up in all those systems.
Yes, it is.
Yep. We talked about monarchy, anarchy. We talked about oligarchy and democracy and the republic and all these systems that the world has accepted, man accepted.
Mm-hmm.
And our churches.
Is governed and ruled by that. Yes,
and,
sir.
And really what God set the church up to be is a theocracy. Mm-hmm. And a theocracy, let me tell you what it says. A theocracy is a form of government that is led by God.
By God. Period. End of quote. Done deal.
And that was the system before the people looked over across the land and says, those other people got a king.
Mm-hmm.
We want one.
We want one.
What happened after that?
They had to sell their children. They had to get rid of their wives, their husbands, their concubines. And yes, Solomon built a very beautiful temple.
He was tall and handsome.
But he made the people go into slavery.
He sure did.
Yes. So we've been dead ever since.
Oh, Lord have mercy. We've been dead. So we're serving Solomon still. And not Solomon, the Saul still today.
We're serving them. Not only that, there's this new system that's out, and it's called 501c3.
Yes, yeah, new system.
Yeah, that's a new system. That system is designed not to depend on God,
mm-hmm.
but to depend on man.
Yes, sir.
And when you depend on man, what's the song? You can depend on Jesus. Yeah.
Andre Crouch.
Yes, sir. I love songs. See, I'm an old schooler.
Ooh, don't you just say Wednesday, L. Jones.
Yes,
can't,
sir.
Don't do this
to me. Oh, you better. Man, I'm on my way,
man,
Wednesday.
Don't do
matter of fact, by the time Wednesday get here, God is already there. Come
yes,
on,
sir.
Somebody.
Yes, sir.
Don't worry about tomorrow. God is already there. So the thing is, the 501c3, we're subject to the rules and regulations of the government.
We are.
Right?
Yes.
So that's the same thing that Israel had. That's the same battle. They were subject to the king, and the king would tell them what and what not to do. So anytime the government issues us something, we're subject to what they tell us to do.
Man.
And then they can pass these laws. The Supreme Court would pass the laws, and then since you are ruling governed by it, you can say you ain't all you want. Mm-hmm. But that 501c3, there are requirements that you have to meet to be able to remain that. And I believe, now, this was the white brother who was a member of faith of Bishop Moody's church. He's
sure.
on the west side.
Yeah, the preacher.
Yes, sir. He mm-hmm. told us, he came back, he said he dropped his 501c3.
Wow.
He said, because he don't need man telling him how to operate God's church.
Ella Jones, let me say something here, brother.
Say it, son. Say it, son.
Well, Bobby Miller said one thing. He said, the political structure in the church, you know what it is?
Mm.
Witchcraft.
Yes, it is.
Yes, sir, boy.
It's mind control.
Yeah. Okay, now watch this, Ella Jones. You talk about the 501c3.
Yes, sir.
All right. Now, you know what public aid is, right?
Yes, sir.
All right, and there's many of us had to dig into that system, okay? Uh-huh. And there are many women out there who they need it.
Yes, I understand.
Okay, and if they don't obey the rules,
they get cut off.
They get cut off, and they could lose their house, everything. Mm-hmm. Okay, and they won't eat.
Exactly.
They're in there, and they're under the almost the bondage of the state.
Yes, sir. And the state becomes their parent.
So the church is receiving
public aid. Yes, sir.
Yes. Yeah. Because if we don't abide by the rules, that'll get snatched from us. Yes, now sir. We're like any other corporation.
That's right. Not only that, but because they pour so much money into you and you build that place with their money.
With their money.
And you close down your old location. Mm-hmm. Now you having church in this center.
Yes.
Hence ministries.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Rather than church.
That's right.
So you have your worship setting in this same location. Mm-hmm. Now you got to abide by what they say do. Yes. The minute you don't, it's theirs.
It is theirs.
Because the law states whoever puts a certain amount into what you got, they got something to say.
Brother, you on top of something here, because watch this also. Hope don't let me lose this, because I was right on to something. I was right on it.
You better get off of it then.
I was right on it. About the 501. Lord, bring it back to me.
Yeah, well, let's go with them Hebrew bros.
Yeah, I don't want to go right there because
I don't
got
go there.
This
don't
where it fits there. Right here.
Right here.
About the
sign.
Oh, I got
age.
It now. Here
senility
it is.
Has set in.
There it is. Thank you, Lord.
Oh, so the Holy Ghost brought it to your memory.
I'm telling you, he brought it to bring it back to my memory. Because
it's important.
It is important. Okay. Remember in Scripture, God told the children of Israel, he says, be kind to the strangers.
To the stranger. Yes, sir.
You know
sir.
Why he said that?
Because thou wast a stranger.
All right.
Yes, sir.
The church right now.
Are not kind to strangers.
They're not.
Right.
This woman who's been giving her tithes and offerings to this ministry, all right, for years. Mm-hmm. Now she's down. She's about to lose her house.
And they won't give her nothing.
They won't support her, although the church is on public aid. Okay?
Right.
They're strangers now.
Exactly.
So God was telling Israel, if you see somebody in need, go help them. Matter of fact, he says, when you're in the garden, when you tilling the ground, what have you, you ship.
Save some, leave some in the street.
Don't and, go and back that, and get it.
Don't get it. Let it be for the poor.
The poor, the strangers.
For the strangers,
yes.
the widows,
come on,
the
man.
Fatherless,
come on, man.
And all of that.
You better preach my message.
Yes, sir.
Okay,
but
so,
I'm going to take your offering.
That's what I'm saying. He said, because you once were strangers.
A stranger.
All right, so the church have no business rejecting people
That's
who
right.
need help. I'm not talking about people who abuse the help. Because I know people keep going back.
You don't think the church is abusing the help?
Yeah, they are. Yeah, I'm too wrong.
I mean, when
right.
we have food programs, we normally give the food to the members first anyhow, right?
We do. Ain't that a shame?
I'm just saying. I'm going to stick over here.
That's a shame.
I don't know. I'm
That's like a bank.
I'm going to sip my tea.
A bank is there to lend you money because you need to borrow money to buy a house or something.
Right.
But they say all of the workers at the bank. They get the money first.
Right.
Okay. And whatever's left, we're going to put towards your house. It's just a sad thing, and I don't think we really realize this. We don't even see it in this light.
Look at Daniel. Daniel, the first chapter, since we're right there. Daniel 1 and 5. So, 1 and 4. Okay, this the king. He says, he looking for children in whom was no blemish. Right, but well favored and skillful in all wisdom and cunning and knowledge, and understanding science, and such as had ability in them to stand in the king's palace, and whom they might teach the learning and the tongue of the Chaldeans. And the king appointed them a daily provision of the king's meat.
Oh Lord,
a daily provision of the king's meat and of the wine which he drank, so nourishing them 3 years. That at the end thereof they might stand before the king. Now among them of the children of Israel, you know, Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Ezra, right?
Yes, sir.
Which we called Shadrach, Meshach, yeah, those guys.
Bad Negro.
Yeah. Verse 8 says, but Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's meat, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore, he requested of the prince of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself. Verse 9, now God had brought Daniel into favor and tender love with the prince of the eunuchs. Now, go down to verse 15, and at the end of 10 days, their countenance appeared fairer and fatter in flesh than all the children which did eat the portion of the king's meat.
My Lord.
I said that to say this. The king wanted these young boys to be on his public assistance. They determined, we don't need your food, your drink. We don't need your 501c3. Mm. God is going to support his body. Because the minute we take your stuff, we are subject to your rules and regulations and your food, which the king would give his food to idol gods.
My Lord.
So Daniel says, I am not going to defile myself nor my God by partaking of your idol worshiping drink and your idol worshiping food. I don't want your 501c3 because I don't want to be subject to your mess, your rules, your regulations, and your ungodly laws and commands. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to just eat the good of the land and survive. Then he says in 3 years, he's going to call them before. Well, God made those boys better in 10 days. You've ever been on a 30-day trial? You on a job? Uh-huh. Or a 60-day trial, whatever they call it? God can make you qualify for the job in 10 days.
Sure,
and you got another 20 days to just have fun with.
Oh, my Lord, man. I tell you, this homosexual law that came down, because y'all accepting 501c3s.
Y'all. All right?
Okay, because y'all accepting this, the government will tell you, you got to marry these people.
You got to do it. And you got to let them use your church.
You got to let them use your church. You got to let them use your restroom. Okay, you got to let, because we're giving you this.
And they
got
to play your orc.
No, they, you know what I'm saying? They're telling y'all this. Y'all better wake up. You talking about some, if they come in my church, I'm going to tell them, well, you going to lose.
Yeah, you're going to get a lawsuit.
Preacher says the hard times we created in church, 501c3 tax exempt is an offense to God on freedom of speech.
Very good. And this not a 501c3 show, but I believe it's the prompting of the Holy Ghost.
It is prompting of the Holy Ghost because I live in South Dakota where the Native Americans live, okay?
Yes.
I'm talking about real Native Americans. I'm talking about some 3% Indian. And 90,
from the Wajahoski?
And 98-97% black. Okay, no. Y'all is... I got Indian hair.
Indian hair,
I'm
right,
like 2.9% Indian. Right. Shut up! I lived in with these people in South Dakota. They 101%.
Mm-hmm.
But you know what? Mm-hmm. We have Mount Rushmore.
Yes.
White man built that.
Yes, he did.
They're building a tower called Crazy Horse.
Oh, yeah.
Monument.
Yes.
Okay? And you know when they started building that? Way back in 1950-something.
Wow.
And they ain't done yet, and they probably won't be done in your lifetime.
Mm-hmm.
You know why?
Mm-mm.
Because the government says, why don't you let us help you?
Gotcha.
We'll give you some money, and they'll be built.
Nehemiah said
time.
The same thing. We don't need your money.
The Native American says, now this is for the first time when their pride finally worked for them.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Because, you know, they're taking this casino stuff, and they all this other stuff.
Yeah.
But they said, no, we don't want a dime of your money because if you give us one nickel, then you will, because you wiped us out pretty much with a trail of tears. If we give you one nickel, you will have what to say on this mountain here.
That's right.
And we don't want a dime. But one family was building that thing over there.
Wow.
That's why it's taking a lifetime to build.
Mm.
And I walked on the head of that thing.
Mm-hmm.
It's an amazing sight. Y'all, when you get a chance, fly down there to South Dakota and see that amazing monument. Mm. Crazy Horse.
Crazy Horse.
I'm going to a break here. Going to do some news.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Crazy Horses. I want to hear... let me do the news first, and then I'm going to go to a song called Lord, I Need You by Matt Maher. So, welcome to the show.
Oh no, did you miss part of today's show? Well, just head to Spreaker.com. That is Spreaker, Spreaker.com, and type in the Sir Walter Jones Show to get today's episode and past ones. So do it now.
Religious Investigation reports from Thursday, May 26th. Today is a Red Nose Day. Red Nose Day supports programs to keep children and young people safe, healthy, and educated. It's not too late to support. Get your red nose today. Is yoga religious? Some parents in Georgia think so. Bullard Elementary School in Kennesaw, Georgia, has issued an apology for teaching yoga after parents complained about the practices having religious overtones. The school has banned the use of the word namaste, I think it's called, which means the light in me sees the light in you. How you say it, Brittany? Forget it, huh? All right, give her a minute. It is a common greeting in India, similar to hello. The school will still teach students the deep breathing and stretching at the core of the practice. Tell us at the Sir Walter Jones Show what you think. Should Christians practice yoga? Hit me up, y'all. Hey, boss. I'm going to need that day off. One of the more anxiety-inducing requests is asking a manager for time away to celebrate a religious holiday, especially when you don't share beliefs. In most cases, employers have a legal obligation to provide accommodation for religious observations and practices. Title 7 under the Civil Rights Act of 1964 says that employers of more than 15 workers must reasonably accommodate employees in sincerely held religious beliefs. That's true unless it causes undue hardship on the employer's business, meaning that it's prohibitively expensive, endangers your coworkers, infringes on your employer's rights, or something equally damaging. If you say, I want the day off for Easter or Passover, and the employer can show more than a small cost in dollars of manpower, then they don't have to accommodate it. Mm-hmm. Check your state. Most states have their own discrimination laws, and religious is a commonly protected class. 10 Bible verses every Christian should know by the heart. By heart. Number 10, Psalms 119 and 11. Number 9, John 14, 6. Number 8, 1 John 1 and 9. Number 7, Romans 10 and 9. Number 6, Romans 5 and 8. Number 5, Romans 6, 23. Number 4, Romans 3, 23. And number 2 and number 3, 2 Timothy 3, 16 through 17. Yeah, 1 John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. This has been from Marilyn Keita for the Sir Walter Jones Show.
Lord, I come. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one. Grace is more. Grace is found. Is where you are. Where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me.
temptation comes my way. When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
I said the last note for her because she faded it out. I don't know what her problem is. Hey, y'all, I'm back. So Walter Jones Show. Yep, I'm he. Aunt Martha's South Suburban, $20 copay. Oh, okay. Aunt Martha's South Suburban. Really? What you know about that, Bobby Miller? You must work for them. I'm going to have to try that out. You know, I got to try them out because Obamacare ain't kicking in yet. I got good health life insurance. But I got to see about, yeah. I will, Michelle. I'll get to take care of. I'm going to take a couple of days off next week. Monday, I won't be on, or Tuesday. I'm going to just take care of Sir Walter Jones. My preacherist Tiss said, please make clear you're not anti-church. No one and nothing mankind has our hand in is perfect. No, not one perfect reason. No one perfect person, that is, in church. Right. We're bringing out some things that you guys have been hoodwinked and bamboozled about for the past 100 years. We got to bring that out. L. Jones, because if I was anti-church, I wouldn't be sitting on your organ every day. Every week. All right? Because here's the thing. It appears that I'm biting the hand that feeds me when I talk about how y'all need to be have a better, a proper, what's the word? Stewards of your money.
Yes.
Instead of being tricked or witchcraft into giving.
Giving, yes.
Because there might be a sickness in your body, something like that. So, Jesus never went out there and said, okay, all right, you sick? Okay. No. You give me, if you sow a seed.
Sow a seed.
All right, I'm going to hear
Common phrase now.
I'm going to hear if you sow a seed. Okay, which got the people thinking that the only way to get a result
is you got to do something.
Especially on Sunday, mm-hmm. And it's financial.
And it's always financial. It's always sowing.
It's always sowing.
Do you know the difference between sowing and planting?
What's that?
Sowing, you throw.
Yeah.
Plant, you dig up and put it in a specific spot.
That is so true.
But when you sow, you throw it, and it's subject to end anywhere. That's why it says some fell on stony ground, some on good soil, because a sower takes it and he tosses it out there.
Like the winnowing spoon.
So when do we plant and stop sowing? So the Bible said there is a time to sow. So if you go to 4 church services, you know how we used to do it. If you go to 4, each person is going to get up and almost condemn you for not sowing
right
into that particular ministry.
That's so true.
But the Bible says he giveth seed to the sower,
mm-hmm.
which also means he provides the seed for the sower.
Yeah.
Which means if you can't sow, it's because the sower, the seed provider, don't think it's time for you to sow.
Oh, my Lord.
So a deer, a female deer. So if you go to 4 services and each one is always going to give you a prophetic word, and for some reason we stopped the willful bringing of the offering, we got to preach the offering ministry now. Mm. And it's called sowing a seed. Mm-hmm. Well, do you have to sow 4 times in a day?
Mm.
I mean, when do you not sow? If he says there is a time to sow and there's a time not to sow.
Oh, my God.
And sowing every church you go to and every time you go to church is not your time.
We've been set up, bro.
Yeah, we've been set up.
I'm really not trying to talk about some of these leaders who do this. I don't know why they do it, though. It's a culture. All right, because your international people do this, right? They come to your church. All right, now here's the setup. It's really the church will turn into a bank. It's really
what it is.
It's a bank.
Is.
All right, there is an offering taken up.
Well, and it's not the speaker's offering.
No, not yet.
It's the general offering.
It's general offering. Because the churches that I visit, if it's a Sunday morning, they do benevolent offers at the beginning. All right, that's one thing, okay? Because people come there with a certain amount in their pockets. They know exactly how it works.
Yes.
All right?
They know the system.
They know the system. So the benevolent offering. And then after a few songs and announcements, what have you, then the general offering is taken. Now, one of the churches that I do visit is they do the benevolent offering first. Then they do the tithe line, just the tithe.
Gotcha.
This is not an offering line.
Right.
Just tithe. Right. They stand up in that long line and then they give that. Then the word comes forth. And then the offering. Okay. Now, if there's a guest preacher.
Yes, sir.
Guess what's getting ready to happen?
The guest preacher is going to preach, and then the guest preacher is going to call for a seed offering.
It's always a seed offering.
Seed offering.
He going to do it.
And it's double conversation because first, the guest speaker tells you, all you got to do is praise God. And he's going to hear you.
Yeah.
Everything is surrounding your praise.
Your praise.
Then before he closes, he's going to challenge you to give a seed offering so that you can receive the whole message that he just gave you.
Yeah.
Strike the records that he then already told you that it's in your praise.
Yes, sir.
Now it's no longer in your praise, but it's in your giving.
It's in your giving. Shh. Bipolar at its best, and we've been tricked by this. And I don't blame the preacher. I blame you.
Yeah, and you know what? Another thing that they do?
I ain't gonna blame the wolf.
That's why we have the musicians, because we are emotional.
Yeah.
We're emotional people.
Right.
And the music, it just causes us to get in that feeling.
Yeah.
Do I have to really make you feel like giving?
Boy, I can't tell you today.
I mean, do I really have to go that route with you? You know, I got to put on the Ohio Players and the whole nine yards and the pedals and the everything just to make you give.
Boy.
To someone who you already love.
I can't stand you, L. Jones.
Something ain't right.
Preacher just said we should not give under compulsion. Okay, I did an entire show under that. I talk about compassion, compulsion, and compensation. Go to that show on Facebook. On you, what's my show?
Spricker,
yeah. Melissa Green says, you said you lost. You just got here. Okay, you won't be lost if you go back and rewind. Demetrius said, cue the music.
Exactly, get ready.
She said, kick back. like the pharmaceutical industry. Yes, that's so true. It's kickback. See, the preacher, the guest preacher, he came there. He can raise his own offer.
He going to raise his own offer.
Okay, now he going to raise enough so that the church can receive something.
And then he'll get something. And if he don't get a lot, it's his fault.
It's his fault. Come on, man. I'm telling you.
Yes.
I've been in this church for 50 years. And
Why you start so late?
I don't know. Shut up. Bobby Mills said, bring in $3 for all three services. One Lord, one faith, and $1. Boy, boy, boy. Sharon Robinson, you late. She just got here, man.
That's my member.
She just got here. It's 5:15. We've been on the air for an hour and 15 minutes.
Wow. I'm going to have to make her stand up before the church.
She the musician.
And apologize. Where was you?
Where were you?
I don't need you to tell me happy. What was that? Stop.
L. Jones, we're going to have to call this show something else because
we left the subject so long ago.
So we're going to have to rename today's show because we initially called it
The Holy Ghost.
The Holy Ghost as it works in the Old Testament.
Yes.
But that's not what the show is.
No.
So y'all give us an idea of those of you who've been listening from the beginning. What do we call today's show?
Yeah. I'm concerned. That's all. I'm concerned about I'm not the world's greatest preacher. I'm not the world's greatest nothing. I'm a lover of God, and I love God's people. But I get upset when I see God's people being hoodwinked or whatever the case may be. We should never follow a trend. We should never follow a trend. We should always be led by the Holy Spirit. The Bible says in Acts 13, 2 and 4, as they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Ghost said, separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work whereunto I have called them. And when they had fasted and prayed and laid their hands on them, they sent them away. Verse 4 says, so they being sent forth by the Holy Ghost departed unto Cilicia, and from thence they sailed to Cyprus. So in this new day that we're in, the Holy Ghost is the one who governs our worship setting.
Right.
The problem is when emotions is not worship.
Right.
But you really cannot worship God without emotion.
That's true.
But we get emotions mixed up with worshiping God. Mm-hmm. And so everybody's hurting, right?
Yeah.
So everybody is looking for a way out of their hurting. Now, something took place with me just a couple of weeks ago when I got ready to preach. And I was like, I really felt convicted because I wanted, see, preachers, what we do, we know that there are people hurting, right?
Right.
So we want to come up with scriptures that will help the hurting heart.
Yes.
And I understand that.
Yes.
Key thing is you got to do what the Holy Ghost says.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
And he alone is the comforter.
Yeah.
So you preach the gospel and he will convict, he will comfort, he will console, he will baptize, he will do the whole work. You just subject yourself to what he says do, and he'll do all the work.
And he will do all of the work.
He'll do all the work.
The Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit.
Will do all of the work. I think we talked about last week about the purpose of the Holy Ghost,
mm-hmm.
As opposed to what we think it is in our ministries.
Right.
Because let me ask you this question. If you polled 10 Christians right now and asked them
the purpose of the Holy Ghost,
what do you think they're going to say? More than most of them are going to say
power.
Power.
Mm-hmm.
Why?
And you know, it will be power to live right, power to live holy, power. You know, the song we used to sing, because they look at or hear the word in Acts 1 and 8. Ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. They don't read the next part. You will be witnesses.
Right.
Which really means effective witnesses.
Yes.
Or prepared to be martyrs. So the purpose of the baptism of the Holy Ghost is to effectuate your witnessing.
Yes.
It's to effectuate it. It doesn't mean that just because one is not baptized in the Holy Ghost that they ain't got no power.
True.
Or I did a thing on the power of a believer prior to receiving the baptism of the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
And you'd be surprised the power that an individual has who's saved, one that has not been baptized in the Holy Ghost. There is a power that you have. And there's two types of powers. There's dunamis and exousia.
Mm-hmm.
One is miracle or force. And the other one is the ability. So when Jesus got up, the Bible said he got up with all power in his hand.
Yes.
I asked the question, what power didn't he have prior to him getting up? I mean, didn't it say he got up and it says all power in heaven and earth is given unto him, right?
Right.
Well, what power didn't he have? I thought he had all power. He cast out devils. He healed the sick. He gave blind man's eyes. He unstopped deaf ears. He rose Lazarus from the grave. He stopped a funeral procession, right?
He did.
That's all power. But then he got upset. All power is now in his hand. What power didn't he have?
Uh-oh.
Well, he didn't have, he did not have authority.
See?
He had force. Power. He had ability, but he did not have all authority. So now he has all authority on earth, and then that's when he sent us out to the whole world.
Well, then let me ask you that.
Mm-hmm.
Remember the conversation that he had with Satan on the mountain?
Yes, sir. I was not there, but I do remember the conversation.
I was there.
Yeah, I know.
I'll be 50 this year. Okay. And it appears to me that Satan was offering Christ something.
Yes, he was. The world.
So, but Christ didn't deny any of that, meaning his response wasn't, no, you can't give me this.
Exactly.
His response was with somewhere else.
Mm-hmm.
So did Satan really have the world?
Did he? Is this the man that wrecked? The tempter says to him, all this power will I give you, for it was delivered unto me and to whomsoever I give it to.
Right.
So the question was, who did he get it from?
Uh-oh.
Yeah.
I know the answer.
Uh-oh. Tango, who did he get the power from? He got it from Adam.
Sure did get it from Adam.
And so he got it from Adam. And then when you get to Luke 9 or 10, Jesus now gives his disciple power and authority.
Mm-hmm.
But then when Jesus gets up out of the grave, because yes, he was going for the world, but he had to get it legally.
He had to get it, yeah.
And he had to get it by God's way and not by the devil's way.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So if he got it from Adam, that means somebody gave it to Adam.
Somebody gave it to Adam.
Who gave it to Adam?
God did. God did it. God said, let us make man after our image and likeness and let them have dominion.
Dominion.
Over the earth.
Which is why Jesus is called the last Adam.
He's the last Adam or the second Adam.
Come on, y'all. Sir. It's all making sense. Now, Sharonda Robinson, you know what she said?
Mm-hmm.
She says, I was here earlier.
I told you she was.
And had to go to
recess.
Had to go to be with mom. She says, I have to take care of home first, Pastor.
Oh, Lucia, you're supposed to take care of church first.
And she said, you choking, Walter, because you were scandalizing my neck. I love hate that woman right there.
Yes.
Woo! My goodness today.
And you know what? Mm-hmm. I told someone that, you know, the church is the body of Christ and the church is the bride of Christ, right?
Right.
And we're married men, preachers. I'm talking about preachers that are married, that have a wife. It's not your obligation to take care of the church more than you take care of your wife.
That's true.
Because the church is the bride of Christ. That's another man's wife. Why are you taking care of another man's wife better than you taking care of yours? So if my wife is in trouble, needing hurt and whatever, and I need to stay home from church, which is Christ's wife, I need to tend to my wife. Because he said, therefore shall a man leave father and mother and cleave to his own wife.
You know what? You know, I'm going to go even deeper with that.
Talk to me. Here we go. When the Jones start laughing before he says something, you in trouble.
Okay, now pastors are called shepherds, right?
Yes.
And the church, the saints, pretty much are the sheep.
The sheep.
Okay. Now, when the pastor sleeps with one of his members, you know what he's committing?
Yeah.
Bestiality. And that's nasty. That's nasty.
It is.
Mm-hmm. That's straight nasty.
And it's illegal.
It's illegal to do that, man.
Yeah, it's illegal.
Yeah. Now, L. Kevin McGee, he's late for class, by the way.
Late.
Yeah,
and he's YPWW.
And he's a YPWW.
No, they started 6:30 in-house, so he's on time.
Oh, that's so true. Okay. We are no longer listening to God, how much and who to give to. This is preachers are saying this. God will tell you to give to another another needing congregant sometimes.
That's right.
That is so true. And it really shouldn't, again, and I know this show sounds like an anti-church show.
Only those who disagree with the Bible are the ones who are going to deem it anti-church.
Yeah, so don't think this is anti-church. We only talking about what we know.
Exactly.
I don't know nothing about the club.
I don't either.
If I visit the club every Saturday, guess what this show would have been about?
Which club?
Club, the hair club for men.
Are you a subscriber? Or you the owner?
I am the owner. If whatever I'm a part of, that's...
You need to know it.
A man who goes to the army, you know, you went to a what's that building across the street from Dad? Used to be the projects. It's a veteran administration.
It's a place where they live.
They live.
Mm-hmm.
Let me ask you this duh question.
Mm-hmm.
Most of the people in that building are veterans.
True.
What do you think the conversation is over there every day?
War. Good God.
Good God. What's good for? Nothing. I see you tomorrow. You know?
Right.
So, what are five preachers on a round table going to talk about mostly? They're going to talk about church.
Church.
Ministry.
Ministry.
And that's just the way it is. This is all we know.
That's right.
You know, we don't know the other word.
I mean, we know all the information of stuff because we study and we have to keep abreast on the facts of life and in the world.
Yes.
But when it comes to scripture, this is what we're supposed to know without a shadow of a doubt.
Absolutely. And if anybody have ever listened to my show in just 1 week, they'll see that I only talk about church on one day.
Yeah, Thursday.
Thursday.
And that's the only day that I come.
You see what I'm saying? Because he can't stand the other day.
Uh-uh.
Monday, we talk about relationships. Tuesdays,
right.
Two relationships, okay?
Right.
Wednesday, music.
Mm-hmm.
Friday, we talk about politics and current events, okay? So anybody who knows me knows that I'm well-balanced.
Right.
I'm a topical teacher.
Exactly.
Thursday is just dedicated to talk about religious aspects. That's all.
Mm-hmm.
How about that? Okay.
Okay, I got a question now.
I got one more question. Now, y'all got 4 minutes on this Facebook app. I'm surprised it didn't cut me off.
Mm-hmm.
So, which is telling me it's probably that was that UBM Wi-Fi that was kind of bad because we're on another Wi-Fi system right now.
Okay.
But people that y'all who are on here right now, don't go nowhere because it's going to cut you off in about 4 minutes and I'm going to come right back on Facebook Live. And for the last 20 minutes of the show. All right? So don't go nowhere. I mean, well, you're going to have to go somewhere because it's going to cut you off in four minutes anyway. It's the countdown. Where did you get ready to say, L. Jones?
Now, the Bible says, you know, in the year Uzziah died, right?
That guy.
Yeah, that one. Now, I don't know. For some reason, many people say that Uzziah must have been in Isaiah's way. Even the song, song Uzziah, it even implies that he was in his way.
Yes.
Which he was not. It only lets you know that the same year that Uzziah died is the same year Isaiah saw the Lord.
It was a date stamp.
It's a date. It's a reference. That's all it is. He was not in his way.
Mm-mm.
But did you notice how many times they said holy?
Yeah.
Three times?
Yeah.
Do you think it was one for the Father, one for the Son,
ooh,
and one for the Holy Ghost?
Oh my.
Or did it was just holy, holy, holy? Because they didn't say two holies.
No.
Didn't say one. They didn't say four.
Ooh.
But we stress a Godhead, and we stress Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
And
yet, why do you think, Facebook help me, why do you think that these angels cried holy, holy, holy?
Man.
And the first holy, I believe, is capitalized.
Uh-huh.
And the other holies is not. Do you think they were referring to God the Father, holy, God the Son, holy, and God the Holy Ghost, holy?
Mm-mm-mm.
Is that what the angels were seeing? Or were they just referring to God by himself?
L. Jones, you're messing me up there.
Ah.
Now, while you was talking about that, notice when that cry comes out.
Yes, sir.
It's a repetitive thing because I went to Revelation chapter 4 and 8. And we're going to do a Revelation study real soon. But the church is gone now. The church is in heaven.
Oh.
Yeah, it's gone. Oh. By Revelation 4, the church is gone.
Did they take their 501c3?
They took their 501c3 and tossed it in the and burning.
In the sea of forgiveness.
In the shield. But verse 8 says, and the four beasts had each of them six wings about him.
Mm-hmm.
And they were full of eyes within, and they rest not day and night, saying, guess what they said?
Holy.
Uh-huh.
Holy.
And what else did it say?
Holy.
Yes, sir. Uh-huh. Lord God Almighty.
Lord
which
God.
Was and is.
And is to come.
And is to come.
Mm.
You see what I'm saying?
Yes. Now, I hear what you're saying, but I just really can't see.
Yeah. So the scripture is so uniformed.
Let me show you something, though.
I'm going to try to see it.
Okay. Now, let's go there.
Uh-huh.
Isaiah 6, 1, right? Verse 8. Uh-huh. Also, I heard the voice of the Lord, right? Saying, whom shall I send? And who will go for us? Then said I, here am I, send me. And he said, go and tell this people, hear ye indeed, but understand not. And see ye indeed, but perceive not. Make the heart of this people fat, and make their ears heavy. Shut their eyes, lest they see with their eyes, and hear with their ears, and understand with their heart, and convert and be healed. Now, that's Isaiah talking to the Lord God, right? Mm-hmm. Now, if you go to the book of Acts.
As they get ready to get cut off.
Yes. Acts, the 28th chapter.
Y'all come back. I'm getting ready to repost.
Mm-hmm. Acts 28, 25 through 27 says, also I heard. Acts 28, 25 says, and when they agreed not among themselves, they departed. After that, Paul had spoken one word. Well spake the Holy Ghost by Isaiah the prophet unto our fathers, saying unto this people, and say, hearing ye shall hear. Remember, we just read that, right?
Mm-hmm.
And shall not understand, and seeing ye shall see and not perceive. For the heart of this people is waxed gross, and their ears are dull of hearing, and their eyes have they closed, lest they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their heart and should be converted, and I should heal them. Now, Paul's saying that this was the Holy Ghost.
He did.
Yet, Isaiah said that it was the Lord. And most likely, you have a reference to it being the Lord and the Holy Ghost.
Right.
Problem is, you don't see Jesus in here.
Nope.
So you only see God the Father. Is it back on?
It is now.
You only see God the Father, and you see God the Son.
Mm-hmm.
So you see the Father in Isaiah. Then Paul picks it up in Acts 28 and 25 and says that it was the Holy Ghost talking.
Oh, boy.
But now you only have God the Father and God the Holy Ghost.
Mm-hmm.
But if you go to John 12, 39, it says, therefore, they could not believe because that Isaiah said, he hath blinded their eyes and hardened their heart, that they should not see with their ears, nor understand with their heart, and be converted.
See with their ears.
Mm-hmm.
Lord have mercy. F, Brittany, F, I surrender.
And I should heal them. Verse 41 says, these things said Isaiah when he saw his glory. The glory of Jesus, when he saw his glory and spake of him. So now you have Isaiah talking to the Lord God, the Father in Isaiah. You have Paul saying that he was talking to the Holy Ghost in Acts.
Right.
And then you have John saying he was talking to Jesus in the book of John or talking about Jesus. You got the Father,
yes,
the Son,
yes,
and the Holy Ghost.
Mm-hmm.
No wonder they were saying Holy Father, Holy Son, and Holy Holy Ghost.
Mm-hmm.
That's my belief.
That's his belief, and I'm sticking to it. Wow. Demetria, Eve Cook, Carla Thomas, Sharinda Robinson, and Bruno Scott, y'all back. Man, y'all. But, you know.
Well, they own it.
I love those people.
Yo, yeah, they.
They be
only one of them is my member. But what about Abronia? Abronia's not my member. She don't. She's not a.
Yeah, she came back.
She came back.
Yeah, that's all. She's the one. Last one I said.
Oh, okay, good. But only one said that they was my member.
Oh, the only one. That's the only one that's gonna claim you. Oh, she got a 501(c)(3).
And I have.
Yep. Mm-hmm. There, you know. Now watch this, L. Jones.
Mm-hmm.
Most of the people who tune in to our Bible study sessions
mm-hmm.
are female.
Oh, yeah, I know that.
Okay. Help us out mm-hmm. with this. Is it the same effect that we see on Sunday morning that there's 90, 95% women in the church will apply to all week long? Men are just not interested.
Men are not interested
in Bible study or the word or something like
that? No, I think what turns men off is our worship services is not geared for men. Our worship services is geared for women because our worship services is full of emotion, but not enough word, not enough proof, not enough challenging of the mind.
That's it.
So I love our women. I have nothing against women, but they move by emotion.
Mm-hmm.
Men are moved by things. Now, the problem is when we say stuff, people say, he lying because that's not me. No, we're never talking about an individual. It's we're talking in a general term.
Right.
Women are moved by emotions. Men are moved by what's been proven and tried.
That's right.
So it's hard to get a man to attend church because he wants his mind to be challenged by the word of God.
True.
That's why the mosques is full of men.
They are full of men, Doc.
Yes, sir.
Farrakhan may be very controversial.
Mm-hmm.
All right. And
he's choosing his words carefully.
You know, I have to choose my words carefully.
Farrakhan may be following him on Facebook.
Faye Farrakhan is listening. Okay. Eve Cook says the honorable women did follow Christ.
Yes, they did.
Yeah. It was the women that did the witnessing.
Yes.
It was women that showed up.
They catered to him.
And it was the men who doubted.
But it was the men who was his disciples.
It was the men who was the disciples.
See, the women followed him and mm-hmm. they ministered to him. Mm-hmm. The Bible did say that. Mm-hmm. But he trained the men.
He did. Women are innate to follow.
Yes.
There's some things of nature that God put into them.
Oh, yes.
To follow and submit and do these things. Now,
exactly.
Now today's woman say, I ain't submitting to nothing. I don't obey nothing. But there's something in her that still
she
causes her to do that.
Yes, sir.
Even though she's trying to fight against the nature that God puts in her.
Right.
That's why women take the obey out of
the marriage.
Out of the marriage
and
vows.
I would perform a wedding ceremony.
I mean, I really don't care about it because what you say out of your mouth ain't got nothing to do with what you're going to do.
True.
Okay, but I see these women who are saying, I don't need no man to do this, I don't need no man to do that.
Right.
Now, she says that in public. She says that on Facebook.
Right.
Well, when she goes home.
And usually she's been hurt by a man, but go ahead.
Mm-hmm. When she goes home, what she watches on TV says something different.
True.
What type of music she listens to says something different.
Exactly.
All right? I've seen them and I've heard them say it out of their own mouths.
Mm-hmm.
I go home and I cry in the corner eating bonbons, wishing that a man was at my house.
Right, and she'll listen to Teddy Pendergrass,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
All the men's singers.
All the men's songs about love and relationship and
exactly.
yada, 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 yada. Okay, so I don't really pay no attention to what people say.
Right.
I'm just like, la, 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 shut up.
Okay? What they say.
But there is this thing that men need to be challenged, like you said
yes,
earlier.
Yes, sir.
And we need to solve problems.
Yes.
Okay, and we are logical people.
Yes, sir.
Not saying that you women don't fit the three that we just said.
Exactly.
But men were built
by God.
By God to
be that.
Be that. So,
and he will never be a woman.
He will never be a woman.
And so, never reduce him down or whatever.
Absolutely not.
To your whatever.
So when a man walks in, I walk into a church. I walked into this one church on the south side, and I realized why men don't go to church.
Mm-hmm.
And I really realized why men wasn't coming to this church. All right?
Mm-hmm.
Not because it was a woman pastor, because there's a lot of men who are part of women pastors.
Yes, there are.
All right?
Mm-hmm.
But this was the big problem I had. I walked into this church, and when I opened the door, there was pink curtains everywhere.
Oh, yeah.
The pulpit was laced with curtains.
When you said laced, I already knew.
It looked like, you ever been to a women's lounge?
No.
Or just a women's bathroom, you know, somebody's...
No.
You ever walk by there? Did you ever have to go in there and borrow some tissue or something?
No.
I have. Trust me. Okay. I walked to some of the places and be like, man, this is beautiful. This looked like, you know.
Eve's house.
Like Eve's house. Okay.
Yeah.
The churches, that church was draped like that.
Yes.
And I said to myself, oh, my God. And it was like a woman's.
Heaven.
Yeah. It was like a nail parlor, like a woman's store.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw two men sitting over there wondering, when is this going to be over?
Right.
Because it was all emotion.
Yeah.
And it was men bashing.
Oh, you know it is.
And I said, this is why these men don't come to this place.
Right.
So what happens is the church changed over, especially the Caucasian churches, and many of the men are showing up to those churches because you know what they did?
Mm-hmm.
They removed the pastor's bench.
Mm-hmm.
They removed the steeple.
Yes, yes. They and he don't sit up in those churches. The pastor don't even sit up in the pulpit.
He don't sit in the pulpit, no.
Yes.
They removed the cross out mm-hmm. of there, okay? They removed anything that remind a man of your traditional church.
Mm-hmm.
They pumped smoke in there.
Mm-hmm.
As a matter of fact, many of their churches are in like warehouses.
Yes, sir.
Okay? Pump up the electric guitars, and men come there because now they feel.
Why you couldn't say organ?
I couldn't say organ, no. Nope. Mm-mm. Hey, DeMonet said he just tuned in. Well, you're going to have to rewind. Go up to the other show that I put on my wall called The Holy Ghost in the Old Testament, which we didn't talk about none of that. We got to rename the topic.
Yes.
Nope. We said Sharinda joined the club. I'm one, too. So what did you say, Sharinda? Let me go up here. I'm a man, I guess. Yes, Sharinda. Yes, sir.
And you know, it's hard to preach truth
mm-hmm.
with facts
mm-hmm.
and the not guilty people not be offended.
The not guilty people not be offended. Oh,
yes.
Boy, you just, can I slap you again?
Yeah.
Is that loud?
Yeah.
You know what?
If you're not guilty, you just not guilty.
You're not guilty, so ignore
why
it.
Why walk away mad? He goes, no, baby, if
it's not about you.
It's not about you. It's about speaking the truth of the gospel.
That's so true.
It's supposed to hurt you.
Yes, it is.
If you're guilty.
Yeah.
And if you're not,
mm-hmm.
don't worry about it.
I talked about manner. I do my manner shows every day,
mm-hmm.
twice a day. I call Midnight Manner and Evening Manner.
Mm-hmm.
My midday manner is a teaching session, and my evening manner is I play hymns. Today I talked about women, of course, posting negativity on Facebook.
It's a lot of that, bro.
Okay. But then, but an hour in, me talking, I'm like, oh my God, this is too long. And then it dawned on me, I says, I began, and this is what the Spirit dropped in my flesh. I heard the Spirit say, people are going to look at manna as always being tasty.
Mm-hmm.
It means taste good.
Mm-hmm.
But remember when manna came from heaven and
yes,
they
sir.
Got tired of it?
Uh-huh.
Okay, oh, yeah. Now the manna had to feed them.
Yeah.
They had to eat.
They had to eat.
And I made the analogy of squash. I hate squash.
Yeah, me too. So we are brothers.
You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
You can put chocolate on it.
Mm.
You can put my favorite drink on it. Don't just pour it on there. You can fry it, dye it later. So I don't want it. I hate squash. I don't care what kind of recipe.
Me too. Just the name of it makes me hate it.
I can't eat it. But it's a vegetable. It's good for you.
Mm.
All right? But I don't like it because it just doesn't taste good.
Right.
That was my manna for today. This don't taste good.
Don't taste good. But it's good for you.
But it's good for you.
Your uncle told me, stop eating what's good to you and eat what's good for you.
Now, preacher just says men don't want to submit to another man.
No, that's not true.
That's not true.
Not true. There's a thing called alpha male.
Absolutely.
And you can have 50 men mm-hmm. in a room
mm-hmm.
and one man take leadership.
Mm-hmm.
He becomes the alpha male.
Mm-hmm.
All the other brethren recognize he's the man.
Yep.
And we submit to him.
Mm-hmm.
We don't kiss up to him. Real men don't kiss up.
No.
Real men stand their ground, but he still understands and respect. This is the head man.
And that's my point.
But if you put 50 women in one room,
yes,
you will hear scratching, cats, dogs, chewing, fighting, screaming. And I'm not saying every woman.
Yes. A man likes to be challenged by another man.
By another man.
Not so much a woman. He wants to be challenged by a man.
And he wants to know.
Yes, he does.
That he's receiving the mm-hmm. truth mm-hmm.
Yes.
of the matter.
Yes.
Not your opinion.
No.
He wants to know that what you're saying is thoroughbred right. And he can live by it.
Yep. Donald Trump effect.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Look how many men follow him.
Yeah.
All right?
Mm-hmm.
Don't tell me that a man ain't gonna follow another man.
Oh, yeah.
If you believe what I believe and you stand hard on it,
mm-hmm.
I'm following you.
Yes, sir.
Now, watch this. There's an old saying that says, the enemy of my enemy is my friend.
Yeah.
You know what that means?
Mm-hmm.
That means that I don't like Rodney Jones.
Right.
I don't like him either.
But
I don't like you. You're my enemy.
Right.
Okay. But you and I have an enemy.
Mm-hmm.
Well, they're like that. My enemy is your enemy.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So what happens is you and I get together.
Yeah.
To defeat that enemy.
To defeat that enemy.
Okay? Because the enemy of mine enemy becomes my friend.
Become my friend.
You became my friend.
Right.
Temporarily until we defeat the enemy. Exactly. Now we're back to not.
But we got to come to a common goal.
You see what I'm saying?
We got to agree.
Right.
And work this out.
When 911 hit and those towers fell, there was no more profiling black folks.
Right. Everybody was
One. Everybody was one, and we came as one to go against Muslims.
That's it. That's it.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So when I got
hear what you're saying, but go ahead.
Come on. So when I got on the airplane right after 911, I had just got on the airplane after it happened, when it finally opened up the airwaves for us. But prior to that, I always was being looked at.
Right.
What is he going to do?
Exactly.
Okay. After that, please. They won't pay me no attention.
No, you looked on now instead of looked at.
It was, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It was the guy next to me who had that turban on. They kept their eye on him.
Yes, sir.
Man, I could have done anything. I could have slipped some guns and weapons in there. No problem.
Exactly. Exactly.
Okay, but they kept looking at him because then there was no more black and white fighting.
Right.
It was America against.
America against that guy, the enemy.
Absolutely. So. Well, you said something. Go ahead.
Well, we have men subject themselves to men, and we subject ourselves to the truth.
Yes.
You can. I visited with a pastor. He's a bishop. He is the same one who watched the children of Jim Baker.
Oh, boy.
Yes. This guy is awesome. Now, I went to his home, and there are other pastors that comes to his home. And he teaches them. None of them are of his organization. But he's a pastor. And all of these pastors from all over goes to his home once a month and sit in his home to be taught by him. And I was in his home. And he ministered to me and spoke into my life some things. And some things took place shortly after I came back to Chicago.
Wow.
But I'm looking at how all of these men, these are great men.
Sure.
But even great men subject themselves to other.
Yeah.
No one is so great until that they don't have someone who they subject themselves to. Even your highest person subjects themselves to someone
to
else.
To someone else.
So, but our, if you want to see a man come to church, change your worship setting.
Yep, that's true.
Change it.
Yep.
And you will see a man. You will see your churches fill up with men. What do women call Jesus? Mary's baby.
Yeah, that's true.
What do men call Jesus?
He ain't be talking about no baby.
Christ the man.
The man.
Men draw men. Just like women draw men, men draw men.
That's so true.
If you want to see some men walking and marching, get a man out there in the middle of the street, let him start walking and see other brothers and other men.
Yeah.
But I'm just afraid to say in many of our churches, and I'm not speaking against pastors, but oftentimes we're seeker-sensitive churches, and we cater to the needs of one gender rather than to the total man.
Oh, my goodness. Lord have mercy.
Speak to the total man.
Speak to the total man. I'm doing a show coming up. Get ready for the show, L. Jones. I'm calling it A Tale of Two Bibles.
Yes.
Okay? There's one Bible, but when a woman read it, she interprets it different than a man.
Yes, sir.
Absolutely. Because, you know, the Bible is very male-oriented.
Yes.
They use masculine words.
Yes,
all
sir.
Through. We just got to talk about Bishop.
Even the Godhead is all male.
All male. Okay, so the tale of two Bibles. The problem that I'm seeing with, and again, this ain't no women bashing show.
No, we don't bash.
Because we just
we
got
the
bashing
women.
The pastors earlier, okay?
Right,
male
right.
pastors. So
we can't
so
bash
we can't
both
be
of them on
not
the
one show.
Show.
Okay, but watch this, L. Jones. They brought me in to help the Chicago Police Department had a choir.
I remember that.
Remember the CPD choir?
Yeah.
They were about 100 strong, all right? They brought me in. Okay, I was the only...
One without a gun.
True. What do you call them? Civilians, right? Brought me in to train them. And I walked in there. I saw two men. Now, I just told you it was about 100 strong.
Oh, yeah.
I saw two men. And it freaked me out.
Because
I walked in there, I saw all these women with weapons.
Yes, sir.
I said, this is not going to be good. Now, the reason why I said that is because I've been a member of several churches, and I've been their minister of music over their choirs, right? And I can't tell you how many times pastors have told me, you're the minister of music, because I can't put her over this choir.
Yes.
I'm telling you the truth, L. Jones. Mm-hmm. He says, I can't put her over the choir because every time I put a woman over the choir, I lose members.
Mm.
These are pastors and bishops kept telling me this, and I've been doing it for 35 years. They say the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
I said, the pastor prior to that told me, he says, women can't get along with each other when it comes to men. They can't.
Yeah.
So when I realized that, I thought it was just a farce.
Ask your Facebook, is that true? About
they saying it's true.
About women, some women say, I can't get along with another woman. That's why a lot of women in the trade, they hang with men.
They hang with men. Matter of fact, most of the women friends that I have says, most of my friends are men.
Are men.
The women cannot identify with who I am. That's just weird. But they keep talking. They keep praising the sisterhood.
Yeah.
But the sisterhood is so broken. So, but Rodney, that 100 voice choir with the two men in it, you know how lasted long? How long it lasted, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. I stood in there as long as I could because it went from 100 to 80 to 50 to down to like 10.
Yeah. Wow.
You know why? Wasn't me.
Mm-hmm.
Because I had left.
Mm-hmm.
I left when it was about 80 of them. When I came back months later, I went to one of the events. About 10 people up there.
It went from a choir to a group.
And I said, what happened? You know what most of them said? That woman leader right there.
Yeah.
And then she had her helper, which is a woman.
Mm-hmm.
We can't get along.
Yeah.
So I started working. So lately, these pastors have been calling me in to train their choirs. All women choirs, because the men ain't joining your choirs no more. They're tired.
It's not. They're tired.
So, what, in 2014, I went way out to some suburb to help out with this choir that had all women, all right? It was a bunch of them. I was like, wow, look at these women. And the women were singing to them. It was great, okay? That's 2014. A year later when I came back, it was about 5 left. And you know what they said to me.
Yeah. Yeah.
That woman and that woman is the reason why I'm not in that choir.
There's a church on 83rd and Damon. It's Walters something. I forgot. Emmanuel somebody. 83rd. I passed it on my way to church. 1700 West 83rd Street. I passed that on my way to church. And I haven't seen it in a while. But I would always see the brethren stand outside in front of the church. I told my wife, I want to go up in that church to see what they're doing. Because every Sunday, I would see those brethren just standing there holding a conversation in front of the church that told me that there are other men. And that attract me and draw my attention to the point till I want to go in there to see what's going on.
Yeah.
And I encourage our brother at our church, let's do that. Let's let the men stand out in front of the church and have a conversation. So when people drive past, they see that there are men standing outside having a friendly conversation in front of the church.
And not in front of the
church.
And not in front of the liquor store.
And not in front of the liquor store, not standing there with our pants down, looking like weird, whatever.
Yeah.
But men dressed for the occasion in front of the house of worship, about to go in to worship God.
You rarely will see that, brother.
Yeah.
You have to go to a mega church to see that.
Yeah.
But it's a numbers system there. Because, of course, if it's a mega church, you're going to have more men.
Of course.
So it's a what they call it, per capita.
Yes.
I think that's the word.
Mm-hmm.
So if that was a smaller church, you would see
it was
less,
smaller. Exactly.
Yeah, less men. Let's see, man, a lot of comments came in. I ain't got but about 2 minutes. This is this preacher just says, this is true. Yes, we women do not get along. We see each other as a challenge. That's right. We do not identify a leader because we all want to lead. Michelle Thomas says, some women don't do well with power or authority. It goes to their head, and they feel the need to make it known that they're in charge.
Right.
It's pitiful. They continue by saying that women are very territorial by nature. Yes, they are. God made us that way in our home. Brother Scott says, all women don't want to lead. The majority of us have better things to do. You mean the majority of you.
You're right, right.
Sharina Robinson says, it's the bossy culture in the church. That's the problem. The people want to rule over others. That's right. I see this problem with men and women. True.
True.
We talked about the men earlier in the show. It's women now.
Did she leave and come back again?
Yeah, she left. She went to go take care of her dad. Yeah. But it's a shame, and this culture needs to change because it's not just in the church. I've seen it in the business world. When I worked for a construction company, remember What was the name of our construction company?
Baker.
Baker Construction. Well, it was before Baker Construction, it was another
Cinco.
Name. Cinco Construction. Okay.
Yeah, I remember.
It was a husband, wife, a company.
Uh huh.
Okay, Mr. Baker
mm-hmm.
started the construction company. He brought in millions.
Mm-hmm.
Then his wife came in, okay,
mm-hmm.
and she was the accountant. She was over the counter. She brought me in as a accountant, and okay. But the women who worked in the office could not get along.
Oh, yeah.
So the wife had to leave.
Mm-hmm.
She had to go home. She said, I can't work here no more.
Yeah.
You know, and I said to myself, why does this happen in everything we do, whether it's church, whether it's in the corporation world, even in the club? Don't let a woman walk in with the same dress as somebody
already.
Oh, yeah,
she got to go home.
Somebody got to go home.
Right.
All right.
I just talked with a lady last year.
She said, whatever.
She says, she is her pastor's armor bearer. Number one.
Uh-oh.
She got no business.
Uh-oh.
Being her pastor's armor bearer.
Lord have mercy.
Number two. I'm a bearer is Old Testament.
It sure is.
That's dealing with the king and all that.
Yeah.
There is no armor bearer in the new Christian church.
I did
church.
An entire show on armor bearer. Okay.
There's no armor bearer.
No.
There is no armor bearer.
Not in the Christian church.
Because your armor is spiritual.
That's
now.
That's true.
Okay, but anywho, she says
just peed off
she's going to have to leave her church
yeah.
or stop being the armor bearer because this guy, her pastor, is getting ready to get married.
Yes.
And there's no way his new bride will allow her to remain as his armor bearer.
Wow.
Number one, she ain't got no business.
She got no business.
Being his armor bearer. Period.
Oh my God.
We won't even get to number two.
Period. What a way to drop a mic. Good Lord. Yeah. That one got me coughing. I want to apologize to Barack Obama and Michelle. We didn't get a chance to interview you. We'll get you in tomorrow. Tomorrow's Friday. We're going to have JC on the show. And we're going to do island music tomorrow. Help y'all out with Christian Jamaican music. Okay? And then we're going to be off the air till next Wednesday. All right? So y'all have a great holiday. See me tomorrow. I'll go to Spreaker.com and hear the rest of the show. This is I Surrender, y'all. This song that's playing, I Surrender by the Brooklyn Tabernacle, I think it's called. Yeah. Great song. Love you guys. Thank you, L. Jones.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Brittany. It's the Walter Jones Show.
My rest, I'm coming to you again. Lord, here I
ladies and gents, if you missed any of today's show, head to Spreaker.com and search the Sir Walter Jones Show and listen to this show and past shows. Now remember, search for the Sir Walter Jones Show on Spreaker.com. That's Spreaker spelled Spreaker.com. And enjoy.
You have been listening to the Sir Walter Jones Show, where Sir Walter Jones provides you with a biblical perspective on everyday life. Stay connected to Sir Walter Jones at his website, www.sirwalterjones.com. Search the Sir Walter Jones Show on Facebook or follow on Twitter at Sir Walter's Music. Until next time, thank you for listening to the Sir Walter Jones Show with Sir Walter Jones.